Our first integration by parts example, and we'll do our next. So it seems like we should already know the antiderivative for natural log. What calculus property do we know about that? The definition of natural log is defined as an antiderivative. What calculus property have we computed for natural log?
The derivative is
1
over x.
Yeah, we know the derivative, but we don't know the antiderivative. And I also haven't talked about it because we haven't figured it out yet. We're about to figure it out. So I'm going to write down in blue stuff that I know. Pretty much, I know the derivative is 1 over x. I could write the definition down, but we won't be needing that for here. But what I don't know is the antiderivative. We're in the integration by parts section, so obviously I'm going to be using integration by parts. When we do integration by parts, we pick a u and take the derivative of u, and then whatever's left over is dv, and we take the antiderivative of dv. So ln x dx should not be dv, because I can't take an antiderivative. So whatever you make u, you better be able to take a derivative of it so you can get du. So thinking in that way, ln x can be u. And we'll compute dv in du in a minute. What is dv? dx. All right, so that's the choice we made. And now we're going to take some derivative and antiderivative. Derivative of ln x, so du equals 1 over x dx. And regular v, what is the antiderivative of dx? You can guess, and we can check.
X.
Let's guess x. So if v equals x, does dv equal dx? Yes, so that is the antiderivative. If you want to think about it as 1 dx, that's fine. Antiderivative of 1 is x. You don't necessarily need to write the 1 in there. So we're going to make these u substitutions. So this is integral u dv with the substitutions we made. And now the integration by parts tells us this is uv minus integral v du. So that's our integration by parts formula right there. And we're just going to write in all of our values. So uv is x ln x. Minus integral v is x. Du is 1 over x dx. So we got x ln x minus integral 1 dx. And of course, the antiderivative 1 is x. And we just finished our, x not 1, minus x. And we finished our last antiderivative, so we're going to get a plus c. And I like to reserve my plus, I write my plus c when my last antiderivative is finished. So this is the antiderivative of ln x. That's probably not what you expected. So you should be a little skeptical. Seems like magic. How do we see if this is right?
Derivative.
So let's check. If I could spell check by doing ddx x ln x minus x plus c. So find this. You do need a product rule. And we already wrote down derivative ln x, so that should not be difficult. So compute this product rule. Now, plus C, of course, is disappears. So what happened? Basically, this product rule canceled out that extra x that we had at the end. So that extra minus x was there to pretty much cancel out the product rule. And if you think about it long enough, you probably could have reconstructed this eventually, but it would not have necessarily been easy, and it could have taken quite a long time to do so. It would probably happen 7 days later when you're trying to fall asleep. You'd be like, oh, if I do this little trick, it might work out. But integration by parts does that little trick for you. So there'll be some integration by parts antiderivatives you get, and you'll think, oh, it's really clever. So we're going to do some more examples here. I circled the antiderivative natural log x because you might need that. So it's a good thing to put in your cheat sheet. You could always figure it out with the integration by parts method, but you'll spend an extra 3 or 4 minutes getting down to there. So I think that's a good thing to go in your cheat sheet. And we're going to do a few more examples. So two more regular examples here. Well, one more regular example and then a crazy one.
Are we going to check all of these?
No. Just that one. I recommend you check anytime your web work is wrong, if typing web work is wrong, and if you have any extra time on your quiz in your midterm that you check. And anytime you're skeptical, you get some result and you're like, ah, it doesn't look right. So let's talk about choices. So what if I let u equal e to the x? What is du going to be? E to the x dx. So did that get more simple or stay the same?
Stay the same.
So it's not necessarily a good or bad choice for you. So there's option one. What is the other reasonable choice for you?
X squared.
We'll try the x squared. What is du?
2x dx.
Oh, so we dropped a power off x. So that's encouraging. So let's keep going this way. I'm going to assign dv is what's left over, ex dx. So our u was the x squared, so everything else is ex dx. What's antiderivative e to the x dx?
E to the x.
E to the x. So if we make this choice, our du gets more simple, and the antiderivative doesn't get worse. So that's a good indication to go with the choice on the right side. Let's finish the choice that we made on the left side. If u is e to the x, what is dv? X squared dx. So if that's v, dv, what is regular v? 1/3 x cubed. So we see that u didn't get any worse, but dv got worse when we found v. So we didn't figure out this was bad until we got down to here. That's where we realized this was a bad choice, or at least not as good as the other one. So I'll write in a highlighter. So this is where we learned this is a worse choice. Than the one on the right. So we're going to go with the one on the right side. So go ahead and use that good choice and make your subs in. And I recommend you write it as integral u dv. I recommend you always write these letters out because it will, first of all, it will tell me as the grader that you're doing integration by parts, even if you do it completely wrong, I'll at least know that that's where you were trying to go. And I'll see your u's and your v's and dv's and all that. The other reason is you'll memorize it a little more every time you write it down. So if you keep writing it down, at some point you might not even need to look at your cheat sheet. Save yourself an extra 10 seconds. So go ahead and make the subs and just keep going. I'll give you a hint. You're still not going to be able to integrate on the next step. But I want you to keep going and see if you can figure out how to integrate it. And feel free to talk to your neighbor. I'll give you 2 minutes for this. Any questions on that first unsubstitute when you're putting all your use Vs, DUs, DVs back in? So we still got this antiderivative to take care of. So you could do it right here, but I recommend you write it somewhere else so you don't have to keep rewriting everything else all the time. So I'm going to solve this antiderivative separately. And what's a good integration by parts choice to make for you here? So you want u to be x, so then du is going to be just dx. And then dv is e to the x dx. So regular v is e to the x. So go ahead and apply integration by parts the second time to this right here. questions on this antiderivative? So this sort of acted like the ln antiderivative, except it was kind of the next level where you had to apply it twice. So you got this. You know, if we took the derivative, we would have product rule in two separate places, and they would kind of cancel each other out in certain ways. And then you have that last term, which would cancel out something else that came out of the product rule. So it's a good time to talk about constants. So here we have minus 2 times a constant. So that's just some new constant. So if you want, what you can do, I'll just call this constant 1, the first constant, and then my second constant I'll just write as plus c, where c is negative 2, c1. It'll just be twice as big and negative of what it was. So you can basically just do your plus c at the very end if you want to. So there is our answer. The one above it is just as good. Doesn't matter if you write plus c or minus 2c. It'll be the same thing. So we're going to do our next problem that will sort of be like this, except it won't end. But we'll make it end. So right here, we had to do integration by parts twice. So we're about to do a problem that looks like it gets better, but it never really does. So we got e to the x cos x. So derivative e to the x, e to the x, derivative cos x is negative sine x. I know we think in the next step ahead, the second derivative e to the x is e to the x, and the second derivative of cosine is negative cosine. So it'll get back to where it started. So both these functions eventually take enough derivatives or antiderivatives, they're going to come back to themselves. So things aren't going to get simpler, is what I'm saying. More simple. So there's no, oh, just pick the x squared term and we'll knock a power off each time. And then two steps, we will have a constant. So that's not going to happen in this situation. It doesn't matter if I go with u as e to the x or u as cos x. So for me, I think it's easier to take regular derivatives of trig functions as opposed to antiderivatives of trig functions. So for that reason alone, I'm going to go u as cos x. So I'm just taking derivatives of trig, antiderivatives of exponentials. So just looking at what this turned into, our integral didn't get any better, really. It changed from being cosine to a sine. But things look like they actually got worse because there's an extra term over here. So before we give up, let's keep going. I want to warn you about integration by parts. If you make a certain choice, you'll go right back to where you started. So what choice is that? Let's think about what we did originally. We took a, let's see, u was cos. So if we want to undo that, I'm going to take my dv to be sine x dx. So I'm going to take my trig part and anti-differentiate it. Whereas the first time I took my trig part and I differentiated it. So I'm going to show you what walking backwards looks like. And I'll do it all on the green marker over here. So this is what not to do. So u will be e to the x dv sine x dx. Can you read the green?
Yeah.
It's good enough? Okay. Du is ex dx. Regular v is negative cos x. So it's e to the x cos x plus integral u dv plus uv minus integral v du. Uv is e to the x times negative cos x minus integral v du. And simplify this. The first two terms add up to zero. They're the same things, but negative. And two negatives at the end make a positive. So what do we accomplish?
Nothing.
We started with the same thing. So okay. Well, at least it's not equal to zero or something strange like that. So that was an exercise in going back to where you started. So I just wanted you to see what it feels like when you basically make the inverse choice. So you're going to end up going back to where you started. And that was done down here because we basically had sine x dx and we took an antiderivative. And if you look over here, so what I circled corresponds to similar things here. And we just changed the names of the letters. That's all that happened. All right, so let's not do that. So this was all pointless. It's good for learning, but not good for getting to the answer. So just wanted to show you what going back to where you started feels like. So let's forget all that stuff. Let's make the opposite choice. So what I underlined is the trig, well, underline too much. We went with trig for our u the first time, so we'll go trig again this time. So let u equal sine x. dv is now, and we'll partition all this pointless stuff off. dv is